Good morning, students. Today we are going to start next topic from unit 1 of class 12, that is human reproduction. In the previous lesson, that is sexual reproduction in flowering plant, you have learned how sexual reproduction takes place in flowering plants, and that will result into production of fruits and seeds. In this lesson, we will be dealing with human reproduction, okay, or how human reproduces. As we discussed before, this unit is very important. Weightage of this unit is also more. Number of questions can be asked from this unit. So I hope you will try to understand each and every concept from this lesson, and we'll try to revise it daily. Okay. So let's start the next lesson from reproduction unit, that is human reproduction. Human reproduction. Before we start the actual lesson, let's have some quick recap from first lesson, that is reproduction in organism. We all know that what is mean by reproduction, what is the significance of reproduction. We know that every organism, every species tries to maintain its existence on this earth. Every species tries to maintain its continuity. So for that, every living organism, whether it is unicellular or whether multicellular, the organism has inherent ability of reproduction. So reproduction, it is an essential process for existence of life, for continuity of race on this earth. Every organism reproduces. There are different methods of reproduction. You have learned some organisms reproduce by means of sexual methods, some organisms reproduce by means of asexual method. Okay? So these different methods, these are well adapted by particular organism depending upon its nature, okay, as well as the availability of environmental factors. Fine. So whether it is asexual reproduction, whether it is sexual reproduction, every individual tries to maintain its existence. Every individual tries to maintain his race, and for that reproduction, it is a very essential event. Okay? You have learned how plant reproduces. In this lesson, we will be emphasizing how human beings reproduce. Fine. Hmm? So again, this is very important lesson, not only for NEET, but as it is related to your own life, you should have all the ideas clear. You are at this stage, or you have now par your maturity phase, okay? So you will be able to understand all this concept properly. So we are going to deal number of aspects related to human reproduction. So we will be dealing with without any hesitation, okay? You are biology students, so don't be hesitate to ask any doubt related to this. All the concepts should be clear in your mind. Fine. So let's begin the lesson and let's try to understand all the things related to human reproduction. Fine. First of all, we know that human beings reproduce sexually. There is no asexual reproduction method for human being. Okay. So humans reproduce sexually. So there is only sexual reproduction. Humans reproduce sexually. There is no asexual method of reproduction for humans. Human beings are viviparous. You have learned that what is mean by oviparous and what is mean by viviparous. Okay? Viviparous means humans give birth to young ones. Okay? Egg-laying animals are called as oviparous. Human beings give birth to young ones. So we are viviparous. So human beings always reproduce sexually, and we are viviparous. Human beings show sexual dimorphism. What is mean by sexual dimorphism? Sexual dimorphism means there are different sexes, that is male and females, in which special type of reproductive cells are produced. So sexually dimorphism, sexual organism. Male sex organs are developed in male body, female sex organs are developed in female body. So we show sexual dimorphism. Male and female individual, they are distinguished externally. In each organ, specific type of reproductive cells are produced. Right? Now, humans have specialized cells, okay, or reproductive cells. These specialized cells are called as gametes, okay. So sexual reproduction in humans, or humans have reproductive cells. Reproductive cells. These are specialized reproductive cells. These reproductive cells are called as gametes. Okay. So human beings produce specialized cells which are called as gametes. In males, these gametes are called as spermatozoa. Okay. So male gametes are called as spermatozoa or sperms. Okay. Whereas female gametes are called as eggs or ova. Singularly, we call it as ovum. Okay. So male gametes, okay, these are specialized reproductive cells. These are haploid cells which are formed by the process of meiosis in potentially reproductive cells, which are called as spermatogonia and oogonia. That part we will see later on. Okay. So male gametes are called as spermatozoa, okay, or sperms, whereas female gametes are called as eggs or ova. Fine. Now these gametes, male gametes as well as female gametes, they are produced in specialized paired organs. These organs are called as gonads. Okay. So these are produced in specialized paired organs. Okay. So gametes are produced in specialized paired organs which are called as gonads. Okay, huh? So these paired organs in males, these are called as testes, whereas in females, these are ovaries. Fine. Hmm? So these paired organs which produce gametes by the process of gametogenesis, these are called as gonads. Fine. Hmm? Now in males, okay, in males, these gonads are pair of testes. As I told you, these are paired organ, pair of testes. Whereas in females, okay, pair of testes and pair of ovaries. Fine. So these testes and ovaries, these are called as gonads. Okay. Now these gonads, these are primary sex organs. In your previous standards, you might have heard about some organs which are associated with reproduction. They are called as primary sex organ. Remaining structures are called as secondary sex organs. So primary sex organs, these are the gonads, which produce gametes, which produce male and female hormones. So these are called as primary sex organs. Primary sex organs, that is testes and ovaries, these are mesodermal in origin. So these some related points you have to remember. Mesodermal in origin. So testes and ovaries, these are mesodermal in ovaries. Okay, huh? So testes and ovaries, these are primary sex organs and they are mesodermal in origin. Now besides testes and ovaries, there are some associated structures, like there are number of ducts, number of glands, okay, which are not directly involved in the formation of gametes or hormones, but they are essential for overall process of reproduction as well as for development of secondary sexual characteristics. These structures, these organs are called as secondary sexual organs. Okay, so primary sex organs, these are gonads, okay, which form gametes, which forms hormones, whereas secondary sex organs are those which are associated structures like glands and ducts, okay, which are not directly involved in the gametogenesis, or they do not produce hormones, but they are essential for overall development or for the overall reproductive development. Such structures are called as secondary sex organs. Okay, so other associated structures, I'm writing here. Okay, other associated structures like glands and ducts. Okay, these are called as secondary sex organs. These are called as secondary sex organs. This you have to remember. Primary sex organs, these are gonads, whereas associated glands and ducts, they act as a secondary sex organ. Okay, they do not produce gametes or hormones, but they are essential for the reproductive maturity. Okay, they do not produce gametes and hormones, but are essential for reproduction. They are responsible for development of secondary sexual characteristics, and development of secondary sexual characteristics. We will discuss in detail which are these secondary sexual characteristics. So one important point we have discussed here, what is mean by primary sex organ and what are the secondary sex organ. You have to remember, primary sex organs are those, which are those, these are your gonads, okay, that is testes and ovaries, which are mesodermal in origin. Fine, they are involved in the formation of gametes. Now what are gametes? Gametes are the specialized reproductive cells. These are haploid in number. Okay, whenever there is a fusion of this male and female gamete, it will result into development of zygote. Okay, that restores the diploidy condition that already you have learned in the first lesson. Okay, so these primary sex organs, they are always mesodermal in origin and they are located inside abdominal cavity. So they are called as intra-abdominal. Okay, in males, before birth, testes comes out of the abdominal cavity, so they are extra abdominal. Okay, this point we are going to study in detail later on. Okay, but primary sex organ, they are mesodermal in origin. Okay, they are present inside the abdomen, so we call it as intra-abdominal. They are involved in the production of gametes, okay, and hormones. Other associated structures like glands and ducts, which are not directly involved in gametogenesis or hormone production, but they are essential for development of secondary sexual characteristics that help in distinguishing male and female externally, okay, as well as for overall development of human body. Fine. Now let's see next point. Okay, let's see some details, few more details of primary and secondary sex organs. Okay, and then we will see the next point. Okay, so as we discussed, primary sex organs, these are gonads. Primary sex organs. Primary sex organs, these are gonads, fine, in males, testes, whereas in males, it is testes, in females, it is ovary, okay. So both are paired structure present in abdomen and are mesodermal in origin. Fine. Now this test is in general, as we have discussed, these primary sex organs, they are called as gonads. Okay, so testes are also called as male gonads, whereas ovaries are called as female gonads. Okay, now these gonads, they possess potential reproductive cells. These cells are called as germinal cells. Okay, or germ cells. In common, we called as germ cells. Okay, so these gonads, they have germ cells. Now these germ cells are nothing but these are potential reproductive cells. They have ability to undergo cell division. Which type of cell division? It is meiosis, which result in production of haploid gametes, that is sperm and egg. So let's see which are those cells in testes and ovary. Here we are taking just preliminary idea, so that you will build up a concept in your mind. This everything we are going to study in detail whenever we see structure and functioning of testes, structure functioning of ovary. This is just to build up the overall idea what we are going to study in this lesson. Fine. Now the testes, pair of testes, they also have potential reproductive cells. These are called as spermatogonia. So spermatogonia are the germ cells in testes. So we can call it as a male germ cells. So in testes, spermatogonia are potentially reproductive cells. These spermatogonia, they undergo meiosis and give rise to sperms. So sperms are haploid structure. In the same way, in case of ovaries, these germ cells are called as oogonia. These oogonia, they also undergo meiotic division and give rise to ova or egg. The process of formation of gametes, it is called as gametogenesis. Gametogenesis. The process by which these gametes are produced, it is called as gametogenesis. Now, sperm production is called as spermatogenesis. Ovum production is called as oogenesis. Why I am emphasizing on these words? Because these words frequently we are going to use. So, you must be habitual with this word. The process of formation of gametes is called as gametogenesis. The process of formation of male gametes, that is sperms, it is called as spermatogenesis. So, this process in which sperms are produced is called as, or this process is spermatogenesis. Now the process in which egg or ovum is produced, it is called as oogenesis. So oogenesis, it is a process of production of egg or ova. This is called as oogenesis. So primary sex organs, testes and ovaries, spermatogonia, oogonia are germ cells, potentially reproductive cells in testes and ovaries respectively. They undergo meiotic division to produce sperms. Now besides this, this gonad also perform another important function, that is production of hormones. I discussed before that gonads perform two important functions. The first one, that is gametogenesis, that is production of respective types of gametes, and the second important function is that production of hormones. So testes also produces hormones, ovaries also produces hormones. These hormones are steroidal hormones. They are steroidal in nature. The development of gametogenesis as well as for development of secondary sexual characteristics. So testes produce hormones, male hormones, male hormones. Group of hormones, it is known as androgens, From that major hormone, usually we call it as a male hormone, that is the testosterone. Fine. So testosterone, androgens are produced inside the testes. These male hormones, they are steroidal in nature. This point you mentioned that hormones of gonads, they are always steroidal in nature. Okay. Androgens, they are essential for process of spermatogenesis as well as for development of secondary sexual characteristics. Just note down these points which I am explaining. Okay. All the points may not be mentioned in the module or in the textbook. So while explaining, whichever things I am telling you, just try to note down as many you are. Okay, huh? So male hormones are called as androgens. Majority or the important from that is the testosterone. In females, group of female hormones are also produced in ovaries, okay, like estrogen, progesterone. Estrogen, progesterone, these are major female hormones. These hormones are also essential for process of oogenesis as well as for development of secondary sexual characteristics. Fine. So gonads, as I discussed, it performs two important functions. First one, that is gametogenesis, okay, and second one, that is production of steroidal hormones, okay, reproductive hormones, male hormones and female hormones. Fine. So these are primary sex organ. Now where are they located? They are located in abdomen. Ovaries are intra-abdominal, okay, but testes are extra-abdominal, okay, but when they are formed, that time they are intra-abdominal. Just before the birth, they descend down out of the abdominal cavity, so they are extra-abdominal. Why are they extra-abdominal? How they descend down? That we are going to study in detail, okay. So these are primary sex organ. Primary sex organ, gametogenesis, hormone production required for or important for overall reproduction, growth, okay, as well as development of whole body. Okay. Now let's see which are secondary sex organ. Okay. I hope you have understood this part. Now the next point, that is secondary sex organs. Now as I told you, secondary sex organs, these are associated glands and ducts. Okay. So secondary sex organs, okay, secondary sex organs, these are associated glands and different types of ducts. They are not directly involved in gametogenesis, but they are essential for storage of gametes, for maturity of gamete, for transfer of gametes. Okay. In addition to this, these glands, they secrete number of substances which are essential for development of this gamete. Okay. Their secretions are essential for overall development of body. So they also play important role in the development of overall reproductive system. Fine. So such associated glands and ducts are called as secondary sexual organs. Now these secondary sexual organs, they start maturing at certain age. You have heard about term puberty. This point we are going to discuss in detail, adolescence and puberty in your 10th standard. By birth, these structures, these organs, they are not developed, even though primary sex organs also. The phase of maturity begins at puberty. Fine. From there, development of secondary sexual organs starts. Okay, and humans are potentially reproductive. Fine. Now let's see which are secondary sex organs in males and females respectively. So as we have mentioned before, they are not directly involved in the gametogenesis. They do not produce hormone, but they are essential for overall reproductive development. Okay. So in males, now let's see which are secondary sex organs in males. Okay. In males, there are number of duct systems. Okay. For example, rete testis, वासा एफरेंशिया रेटेटेस्टिस, वासा एफरेंशिया, वासा डेफरेंशिया, और यू कैन कॉल इट एज वास डेफरेंस और वासा डेफरेंशिया. देन एपिडिडाइमिस, epididymis, okay. These are ducts. Besides these, there are three important glands, namely seminal vesicles, Cowper's gland, also called as bulbourethral gland, okay. Cowper's gland, seminal vesicle, and prostate gland. External genitalia, that is penis. Okay, these are secondary sex organs in males. Okay, all the structures we are going to study in detail. Right now, just build up all the concepts in your mind. Fine. In males, retetestes, vasa efferentia, vasa deferentia, epididymis. All these are tubular structures. These are tubules. Okay. Plus three glands, that is seminal vesicles, Cowper's gland, which is also called as bulbourethral gland, prostate glands. Okay, these are glands, and external genitalia, that is penis. Okay, plus ejaculatory duct, which helps in deposition of semen or sperm. Okay. Let's see in females which are secondary sex organs. In females also, besides ovaries, there are associated ducts like oviducts, which are commonly called as fallopian tube. So fallopian tubes or oviducts. Then uterus, which is also called as womb. Okay. Then vagina, okay. Then external genitalia, Bartholin's gland, and mammary gland. Okay. These are associated structures, not directly involved in hormone production or gametogenesis, but as they are important in development of secondary sexual characteristic. Fine. So these are secondary sex organs in males and females. Fine. Now let's see from when our reproductive organs they start developing, okay, or from when humans are said to be potentially mature for reproduction. Now the stage of reproductive maturity is called as puberty. Okay, this part you have learned before. Yes, puberty. What is puberty? Puberty, it is a stage of sexual maturity, a stage or phase of sexual maturity. Okay, so puberty, it is a stage of sexual maturity. Okay, now what happens at puberty? Puberty, primary sex organs become functional. They start producing gametes and steroidal hormone. Whereas secondary sexual organs also develop and they start producing secondary sexual characteristics. We are going to study what are the secondary sexual characteristics in male and females respectively. So at puberty, primary sex organs become functional. Okay, what happens during puberty? Primary sex organs become functional. Primary sex organs become functional. They start producing gametes. Start producing gametes.
start producing gametes and hormones.
So at puberty, process of gametogenesis begins and hormone production begins. Then at puberty there is a development of secondary sex organs and appearance of secondary sexual characteristics.
Development of secondary sexual or secondary sex organs and appearance of secondary sexual characteristics. Appearance of secondary sexual characteristic.
Appearance of secondary sexual characteristics. There is different age in girls and boys from where this period began. Now this is a period where there is a rapid growth, physically as well as physiologically.
So there is rapid growth of body in girls, the age of puberty is between 11 to 14 years, whereas in boys, the period of puberty starts from 12 to 15 years.
So from this age, girls and boys, they are said to be potentially reproductive because process of gametogenesis has begun. Males and female hormones are going to start. So human body is potentially able to undergo reproduction. Now, this development of secondary sexual characteristics, obviously this is under the influence of hormones. So that is the testosterone and estrogen. So we call it as testosterone as a male hormone and estrogen as a female hormone. Now let's see which are those secondary sexual characteristics.
Secondary sexual characteristics which develop at puberty in boys and girls.
That can help in distinguishing males and females externally.
So in males, let's see which are those secondary sexual characteristics.
So in male, appearance of facial hairs, as well as hairs on chest,
So appearance of facial and body hairs. Appearance of facial and body hairs.
So usually on face, usually on chest, armpits. Appearance of body hair. There is a sudden increase in height.
So increase in height.
Shoulders become broadened, and there is an increased musculature.
Shoulders broadens, increased musculature.
The strength of muscles is increased. Voice become low pitched.
Development of low pitched voice.
Voice become low pitched, and pelvic girdle is usually narrower, but it is stronger.
So narrower but stronger pelvis.
Most of the time at puberty we get acne, pimples on the hair, acne and pimples on the skin. So this is a natural process because hormones start producing, there is a hormonal levels of hormones increased in body.
So at this stage levels of hormones okay, like FSH, LH, okay, the increases in body level of hormone increases. This hormonal imbalance may result in formation of acne or pimple. You may have the oily skin, but this is a temporary phase, okay, because whenever you are at the stage of adolescence, your body is maturing, your reproductive organs are on the stage of development, hormonal levels are increasing in the body, so this will result into acne or pimple. So don't do any remedies for this. This is a very natural process. Okay, huh? Then let's see in girls or in females, which are the secondary sexual characteristic. Okay, secondary sexual characteristics in girls that include enlargement of breast, enlargement of mammary gland or breast. Okay, there is a deposition of fats. Okay, for example, at arms, okay, in thigh region, in bullock region, so that start building the feminine counter. Okay, huh? So deposition of fat, deposition of fats in body, okay, to form feminine counters. Fine. So the major event which occur during puberty phase, that is the enlargement of breast, then deposition of fats in body, then high pitched volume. Okay. Usually in males, shoulders get broadened, but in case of female, pelvic girdle or the pelvic region gets broader. Okay. So pelvis broaden, okay, as compared to shoulder. Okay, huh? Then again, level of hormones increases in body. So level of FSH, LH, estrogen, progesterone, increases in body. Okay, so that is responsible for overall development of secondary sexual characteristic. So at this age, you might have observed the changes in you. That time your body had preparing for reproductive maturity. So this is called as puberty period. Fine. So this is the background which is essential before we start the human reproductive system, or before we start learning reproductive systems. Fine. So these basic things you have to remember, okay, because these are common things, terms also we have discussed over here. Now after this we will start first, that is male reproductive system. Okay, so let's study male reproductive system. I hope you all are noting down these points. Okay. Now let's start with male reproductive system. Okay, male reproductive system. First we will see which points we are going to study in male reproductive system. In male reproductive system we are going to study structure, different types of components which make the male reproductive system, that include testes, okay, that include, so we know that primary sex organs, secondary sex organs, so their structure, their function. We are going to study the process of gametogenesis, that is spermatogenesis, how sperm production takes place, how sperms are matured, what changes takes place during maturation of sperm. So what is the detailed process of spermatogenesis, how sperm production takes place, okay, how ejaculation takes place, okay, huh? How these sperms are deposited to the female reproductive tract at the time of copulation.
okay, or what is the nature of sperm, okay, everything we are going to study, okay. We are going to deal with some abnormalities related to male reproductive system. So till gonads, okay, secondary sex organs, spermatogenesis, structure of sperm and hormonal regulation of gametogenesis. We know that there is a male sex hormone, that is testosterone. Besides that, there are some other hormones like FSH and LH, okay, which are secreted by hypothalamus. So these secreted by pituitary gland, sorry, they also regulate the process of spermatogenesis. So how these hormones, they regulate the process of spermatogenesis, that also we are going to study in detail. We are going to see the anatomical structures of testis, okay, seminiferous tubule in detail. Fine. So let's begin with male reproductive system. If you have NCERT, just keep the figure of male reproductive system in front of you so that you will be able to understand this easily. Now first let's see which parts make the male reproductive system. So male reproductive system consists of primary sex organs as well as secondary sex organs. Primary sex organs and secondary sex organs. Primary sex organs include pair of testes. Okay. Now what is the function of testes? Why I am repeating this point? So that it will fit in your mind permanently. Okay, huh? So pair of testes perform two important functions: spermatogenesis, that is production of sperm, and second one, production of male hormones. These are two functions of testes. Testes are gonad and they are mesodermal in origin. Now secondary sex organs include associated glands and ducts, okay, huh? So we can classify them as ducts, glands and external genitalia, okay, huh? So these are three secondary sex organs, fine, ducts, glands and external genitalia. Okay, now ducts, as we have discussed before, there are four major ducts, namely rete testis, vasa efferentia, vasa deferentia and epididymis. These are four ducts. These ducts are involved in transport, storage and maturity of sperms. Okay, so I will mention here, these ducts are involved in transport, maturation and storage. Transport, maturation and storage of sperms. When we will see in detail each of this, we will understand what is the function of these different glands. But overall, these glands are essential in transport, maturation and storage of sperms, which are produced in testes. Now glands, as we discussed, there are three important glands, namely seminal vesicles, Cowper's gland or bulbourethral gland, Cowper's or bulbourethral gland, and third one, prostate gland. Okay, these glands secrete number of substances like different types of enzymes, different types of chemicals, okay, which are part of semen. okay, and that provide nourishment and lubrication to the sperm and to external genitalia. Fine, this also we are going to study in detail. And external genitalia, that is penis, it is the ejaculatory organ. Penis, it is a common organ for passage of urine as well as for passage of sperm. These are different parts of male reproductive system. Each of this we are going to study in detail. So slowly we will see each and every point. Try to understand everything. Don't keep a backlog. Fine. So as soon as we are moving ahead, you just try to solve questions based on this part, so that these concepts will be clear and there will not be any backlog. Fine. So let's start the first one, that is testes. Okay. So let's begin with the first part of male reproductive system, that is testes. Okay. You just draw this flowchart. Let's begin the structure of testes. Okay, this lesson is going to continue for number of days. Okay, but I will try to make it more interactive and more interesting so that you won't get bored. Fine. So let's see the first organ, primary sex organ, male, that is testes. Again, I have told you so many related things we are going to study. I will try to manage it. Okay. So humans have one pair of testes, okay, as primary sex organs. Okay. So one pair of testes as primary sex organ. Now these testes, they are smaller in size, usually 4 to 5 centimeters in length or 2 to 3 centimeters in width. Okay. So size wise they are small in size, nearly 4 to 5 centimeters in length. 4 to 5 centimeters in length and 2 to 3 centimeters in width. Okay, this much smaller they are. Now these testes, they are located in a small pouch like structure that is known as scrotum or scrotal sac. Okay, so testes are located in a pouch like structure that is called as scrotum, okay, or scrotal sac. About this scrotum also we are going to study. Okay, so located in scrotum or scrotal sac. As I told you, these testes are extra abdominal because the scrotum, it is located outside the body. Testes are present in the scrotal sac or scrotum. So testes are extra abdominal. Okay, testes are extra abdominal. Extra meaning outside. They are located outside the abdominal cavity. Extra abdominal. Very important point, students. Okay. They are extra abdominal. Okay. Now I'm going to tell you why are they extra abdominal. Why are they not located inside the abdomen? Now, the scrotum, it is a pouch of highly pigmented skin, folds of skin. It is dark in color. Okay, huh? It contains testes which are extra abdominal. Now, why are they extra abdominal? For spermatogenesis, 2 to 2.5 degrees less body temperature it is required. Okay, because the spermatogonia, which are our potential reproductive cells, these are sensitive to higher temperature. Okay, so for that sake, for the process of spermatogenesis, nearly 2 to 2.5 degree less temperature is required than the normal body temperature. Because of this, these testes, they are not located inside the abdomen, but they are located outside the abdomen so that they can get the required low temperature for spermatogenesis. Remember this point. On this point, questions can be framed in number of ways. Why testes are located extra-abdominal? Because for spermatogenesis, 2 to 2.5 degrees less temperature, less than body temperature, it is required. Spermatogonia, which are reproductive cells, germ cells, they are sensitive to high temperature. Okay? For that sake, testes are not located inside the abdomen. They are present outside the abdomen in a pouch, okay, of highly pigmented skin that is known as scrotum or scrotal sac. Fine. But are these testes formed extra abdominal by birth or during embryonic life only? So no. Okay. When these testes are formed, that time they are intra abdominal. Okay. In a fetal life, suppose there is a baby boy, okay, at the embryonic stage. So that time, during 7 to 8 weeks of pregnancy, okay, or during 7 to 8 weeks of embryonic life, testes are formed. Okay. So testes appear during 7 to 8 weeks of embryonic life. That time they are intra-abdominal. They descend into scrotum, okay, at the time of 7 to 8 months of pregnancy or just before the birth. See, I just try to understand this point. This is very important. Testes are developed in 7 to 8 weeks of embryonic life, but they descend into scrotum. They come out of abdomen, descend down into scrotum in 7 to 8 weeks of pregnancy or before birth. Till that, they are intra-abdominal. Before birth, in 7 to 8 months of pregnancy or 7 to 8 months of embryonic life, 7 to 8 months of fetus, they descend into scrotal sac and become extra-abdominal. Fine. So when are they formed? Testes develop during 7 to 8 weeks of embryonic life, but they descend into scrotum during 7 to 8 months of pregnancy. So why are they extra abdominal? Because for spermatogenesis 2 to 2.5 degrees centigrade less 2 to 5 degree temperature less than body temperature is essential. So they are extra abdominal. Okay. Testes develop during 7 to 8 weeks of embryonic life, 7 to 8 weeks of embryonic life. At this stage, they are intra-abdominal. This point you have to remember. When testes are formed, that time they are intra-abdominal. Now, in 7 to 8 months of pregnancy or during 7 to 8 months of fetal life, they descend into scrotum, and become extra abdominal. Okay, so in 7 to 8 months of fetal life or just before the birth, okay, this testes, they descend down into abdomen, that is known as, okay, or at that time they are called as extra abdominal. Fine. Now, what will happen if these testes, they fail to descend into scrotal sac? Obviously, it will lead to abnormalities. What type of abnormality can we cause? Yeah, for that, you should understand why it is essential for testes to be present outside the abdomen, because For spermatogenesis, 2 to 2.5 degrees less body temperature is required than normal body temperature. If because of some reason, if testes fail to descend into scrotal sac, it will interfere with gametogenesis. So that time sperm production will not take place. Okay. So this clinical condition in which testes fail to descend in scrotum sac, it is known as cryptorchidism. This term you have to remember. Very important term it is. Okay. So I'll just rough this part. Okay. So a clinical condition or the abnormality in which testes fail to descend in scrotal sac, that is known as cryptorchidism. Okay. So failure of testes to descend into scrotal sac. Descend into scrotal sac is known as cryptorchidism. Okay, so the condition in which testes fail to descend into a scrotum from abdominal cavity, it is known as cryptorchidism. In this case, what happened? Okay, they cannot develop and mature properly. It may lead to the malignancy. Okay, if these testes remain in the abdominal cavity, so they cannot mature and function normally. Okay, so interfere, or in this case, testes cannot mature, and function normally. Okay, it may lead to malignancy, Okay, now this cryptorchidism, it may be of two types depending upon whether there is a failure of only one testis or both the testis. Okay, so accordingly it is known as unilateral and bilateral. Okay, so cryptorchidism, it could be of two types. Okay, unilateral cryptorchidism and bilateral cryptorchidism. In unilateral cryptorchidism, only one testis failed to descend in scrotal sac, whereas in bilateral cryptorchidism, both the testes, they fail to descend into scrotal sac. So in unilateral, it may happen that one testis which has come down in scrotal sac, it may be functional and it may behave normally and will undergo normal process of spermatogenesis. So cryptorchidism is a clinical abnormality where there is a failure in this descending down of testes into scrotal sac. It will interfere with the process of gametogenesis, okay, and functional maturity of testes. Now, are we going to keep these testes as it is into intra-abdominal? Okay, so there is a surgical process by which these testes, they are brought into scrotal sac. Okay. So there is a small operation, there is a small surgical process. Okay. That is known as orchidopexy. Okay. So orchidopexy, it is a removal of testes from abdomen. Okay. And they are brought into scrotal sac. That is known as orchidopexy. Okay. So orchidopexy, next terminology. Orchidopexy. Okay. So in orchidopexy, what we do? We surgically brought intra-abdominal testes down into scrotal sac. Okay. So surgical removal of testes from abdomen and brought into scrotal sac.
Okay.
So that method, that surgical method is known as orchidopexy. Okay, huh? See, number of things I am explaining you, I am trying to give you as much I can. So what we have discussed, testes, humans have a pair of testes, okay, small in size, nearly 4 to 5 centimeters in length, 2 to 3 centimeters in width. They are extra abdominal, located in a pouch of highly pigmented folds of skin, okay, that is known as scrotum or scrotal sac. Okay. Why they are located extra abdominal? Because for spermatogenesis, 2 to 2.5 degrees less temperature than normal body temperature it is required. The spermatogonia, which are potentially reproductive cell, they are highly sensitive to higher temperature. Because of this, to maintain the lower temperature, testes are not located intra-abdominally, they are located extra-abdominally. Fine. Now, testes develop during 7 to 8 weeks of embryonic life, but they descend into scrotum during 7 to 8 months of fetal life. If testes fail to descend into scrotum, that clinical abnormality or term it is known as, yes, cryptorchidism. This cryptorchidism, it may be unilateral or it may be bilateral. If only one testes fail to descend, that is known as unilateral. If both the testes fail to descend, that is known as bilateral. Then surgically these testes are brought into scrotum. That surgical treatment or that treatment it is known as orchidopexy. Okay, huh? So by this technique, testes can be brought back into the scrotal sac and it can lead to normal spermatogenesis. Fine. Now, the next one important term that is known as castration. You might have heard about this castration. Castration. Okay. Now castration, it is done in animals. Okay. Castration, it is nothing but it is a crushing of testes. It is nothing but the crushing of testes. Okay. Usually done in animals. Usually done in animals. Okay. Now what will happen? Now usually done in animals like horses, bulls, fine. Now at this time what happened? When these animals or when we use this treatment in this animal, there is a fall in the level of male hormone, that is the testosterone. We know that testosterone is has a significant role in the aggressiveness. Okay, it is responsible for the aggressiveness. If we take the example of bull, we know that bulls are more aggressive. So this aggressiveness, it is because of the increased level or increased amount of male hormones, that is testosterone. But when we crush these testes, level of testosterone falls down. So these aggressive bull, okay, they become obedient bullocks, okay, and then they can be used for any agricultural work, okay, or to carry out goods, fine. So this process helps in conversion of aggressive bulls into obedient bullocks, okay. So castration, crushing of testes, okay, so it brings decrease in testosterone. It been decrease in the level of testosterone, level of testosterone, okay, and can use to convert aggressive bulls into obedient bullocks. So in bulls, this method or this technique, it is usually done, okay, can convert aggressive bulls into obedient bullocks. Okay, and then these bullocks will have less aggressiveness and they can be used for agricultural work or to kick or to transport or to carry number of goods. Fine. So this process, it is called as castration. Fine. Now there are some animals in which
testes are naturally present intra-abdominally. They never descend into scrotum. So in that case, it is not harmful. Okay? It do not cause any defect or any abnormality in some animals. Okay? Like there is an elephant, there is some aquatic mammals like whale, dolphin, seals, some prototherians, okay? Like egg-laying mammals like duckbill platypus, like your ornithorhynchus. Huh? In them, testes are located permanently in the abdomen, but it will not cause any type of defect. In seasonal breeders, in first lesson you have seen there are some seasonal breeders, there are continuous breeders like dogs and cats, these are seasonal breeders. In them, testes are usually located intra-abdominally, but during breeding season, testes are descend down into scrotum. After breeding season, they again become intra-abdominal. So this one point we will mention. In some mammals, testes are permanently intra-abdominal. This question can be asked. They can give you a list, and from that, which is the exception or which mammals have intra-abdominal testes. Okay, testes are intra-abdominal. Okay, it will not cause any defect, any problem to the reproductive maturity. Okay, do not cause any defect by nature. Okay, testes are located intra-abdominally. Like elephants, examples like elephant. Okay, some aquatic mammals like dolphin, whales, some egg-like mammals or prototherians like ornithorhynchus or your duckbill platypus. Okay, they have their testes permanently intra-abdominal. In seasonal breeders, okay, in first lesson, from first lesson you may recall what is mean by seasonal breeders, what is mean by continuous breeder. Humans are continuous breeder. Once reproductive phase starts, we are continuously reproductive. There are some animals which are reproductive during certain phase of year or certain phase. They are known as seasonal breeders. In seasonal breeders, okay, like cats, dogs, okay, in them, testes are naturally intra-abdominal, but before breeding season, they descend down into scrotum, or during breeding season, descend or become extra abdominal. Okay, huh? During breeding season, it becomes extra-abdominal. This point also you have to remember. Fine. Huh? These are some basic things. Still, we have not seen the structure of scrotum, structure of testes, anything. Okay. Quickly, I'll just revise this, and then we will see what is the structure of scrotal sac. Okay. Now, till orpidopexy, we have seen what is mean by castration. That also we have seen. In case of some mammals, testes are permanently intra-abdominal. In some seasonal breeders like cats, dogs, okay, they are intra-abdominal, but whenever the breeding season starts, whenever the process of gametogenesis begins, that time they become extra-abdominal. Fine. Up to this, I hope you all have understood this part. Okay. Now, let's see the next part. How these testes are located in the scrotal sac. So for this, we have to see the structure of scrotal sac. Sure. Now, the scrotal sac or scrotum, it is a pouch-like structure. Okay. It is a pouch of highly pigmented skin. It is a lobed structure. Two lobes. It has a slight septum in between, that is called as scrotal septum. So this is the scrotal sac, extra abdominal, but it is in contact with the abdomen by a narrow canal. Okay, fine. See, again I'm going to explain you all the things related to it. Try to understand everything. Okay, huh? So this is the scrotum or scrotal sac. Okay, dark color, highly pigmented folds of skin, pouch like structure in which testes are located. Now this is called as scrotal septum. Scrotal septum, a partition like or a septum between two lobes of scrotum, that is called as scrotal lobe. Now each lobe holds testes in it. So in each side there is a testis, small size testis is located. Okay, huh? Small size testis is present in each chamber. The scrotum is in connection with the abdominal region by means of a narrow canal, that is known as inguinal canal. Okay, huh? So there is a narrow canal between the scrotum or the cavity of scrotum and abdomen, that is known as inguinal canal. Okay, slowly I will try to explain all the things. This is the pouch which is in contact with the abdomen. There is a narrow canal, okay, through which it is in contact with the abdomen, that is known as inguinal canal. Fine, first up. Now this inguinal canal, it is a passage through which blood vessel, different types of nerves, vas deferens, okay, they are coming and going out. So that much part is only open, remaining area it is closed. Okay, so inguinal canal, it is a passage by which scrotal sac is in contact or is in connection with the abdominal cavity. Fine. Now these testes are attached to the wall of scrotal sac by means of a network of elastic fibers. Okay, this is known as gubernaculum or mesorchia. So just try to see here, these testes, okay, are attached to the dorsal wall of scrotal sac by means of elastic fibers. Okay, network of elastic fibers, that is called as gubernaculum or mesorchia. Okay, gubernaculum or mesorchium. Okay, so gubernaculum or mesorchium, it is a network of elastic fibers, network or tract of elastic fibers attaches testes to dorsal wall of scrotal sac or scrotum. Okay, so by this elastic band, this testis is attached to the scrotal wall. Fine. Now the wall of scrotal sac, it is internally lined by premaster muscles and deltoid muscles. Two types of muscles are present in the wall. Okay, both of them, they play a very important role. Okay, premaster muscle and deltoid muscle. Fine. The testis is in contact with the scrotal wall, or it is hanging position by means of spermatic cord. Okay, so here we will see, on every testis there is a highly coiled structure, that is known as epididymis. Okay, epididymis, this is a coiled structure as we discussed before. Okay, epididymis plus testis, it is called as testicle. Okay, from here the end of this epididymis, it forms the vast difference. Vast difference leave the scrotal sac. Okay, huh?
So along with this vast difference, blood vessels, nerve vessels, okay, it forms a cord-like structure that is known as spermatic cord. So this spermatic cord helps the testes, or it maintains the position of testes inside the scrotal sac. Okay, so this vas deferens, okay,
so this is the vas deferens or vasa deferentia.
Okay, vasa deferentia associated with this
some blood vessels that I'm just showing for your understanding. Okay, some blood vessel, nerve vessels,
they form a cord like supportive structure to this testis. This structure is called as spermatic cord. Spermatic cord. Okay, so spermatic cord passes through inguinal canal and it goes in abdominal region. So spermatic cord, it is made up of what?
Spermatic cord, it is made up of vasa deferentia, okay, plus gonadal veins. Gonadal veins, gonadal arteries, plus nerves. Okay,
so all these vessels, all these nerves, they form, all these vessels, these nerves, they form a cord like structure that is known as spermatic cord. Spermatic cord, it is attached to testes. It helps to maintain the position of testes inside the scrotal sac. This spermatic cord comes into abdomen through this inguinal canal. Fine. Now the next part, the muscles of scrotal sac. Very important point. The wall of scrotal is composed of cremaster muscle, okay, and diatos muscles. Two types of muscles are present. This is the muscle wall. This is scrotal wall. Scrotal wall. Okay. Scrotal wall is internally lined by cremaster muscle, okay, and spermatic fascia. Okay, cremaster muscle, internally scrotal wall is lined by cremaster muscle. Cremaster muscles, okay, as well as diatos muscles. Okay, cremaster muscles and diatos muscle. Okay, huh? Just try to understand their functions. Okay, cremaster muscles and diatos muscle. Cremaster muscles, what they do, and diatos muscle, what they do. Their function is very important. Questions can be framed on it. So cremaster muscle and diatos muscle. Cremaster muscles help in elevation of testes in cold and warm climate. Okay, so cremaster muscles help in elevation of testes. Okay, so cremaster muscle and diatos muscle. Okay, these are lying inside the wall of scrotal as well as the inguinal canal. They help in elevation of testes. Okay, so these muscles help in elevation of testes. Okay, first we will mention this cremaster muscle line internal or the line scrotal wall. Scrotal wall as well as inguinal canal. Inguinal canal. Okay, this cremaster muscle, they help in elevation of testes. I will explain this point. Elevation of testes. Okay, the second type of muscles which are present, these are called as diatos muscle. Okay, now these diatos muscle, they regulate that temperature during cold and warm season. Okay, huh? So during cold and warm season, what will happen? We know that if the outside temperature, it is lower than the normal temperature which is required for spermatogenesis, again we have to maintain the normal body temperature. Okay, so this diatos muscle, they help to maintain the temperature during cold and warm season. How? That I will explain. So these diatos muscle help to maintain temperature in cold and warm season. Okay, in cold season, what will happen? In cold season or cold temperature, these muscles contract, whereas in warm season, these muscles get relaxed. Now why during this season, or why in warm or cold temperature these muscles are going to contract and relax? See what happened. Both of these muscles, they function in a coordinated way, that is a cremaster muscle and diatos muscle. If the outside temperature is lower, okay, or if outside temperature it is much more lower than the normal which is required for spermatogenesis, at that time what happened? This diatos muscle, they contract, okay, and testes are elevate with the help of this cremaster muscle, these testes are pulled toward the abdominal cavity so that the normal temperature for spermatogenesis gets maintained. See what is happening, how both of these muscles, they play in a coordinated way. Diatos muscle, they contract, okay, if or in the cold region, and these testes are pulled up by means of this cremaster muscle, and these testes are brought near to abdominal cavity. Okay, we know that body temperature, it is maintained, okay, so that required temperature for spermatogenesis will be available. Now in the hot season, okay, or when the outside temperature it is much more higher, okay, then these diatos muscle get relaxed, okay, and these testes, they are again brought away from the abdomen so that lower temperature can be maintained in the scrotal sac. So this cremaster muscle as well as diatos muscle, cremaster muscle is help of elevation of testes, whereas diatos muscle, they maintain the scrotal temperature. During contraction and relaxation, energy exchange or the energy is released, okay, so temperature is maintained for normal process of spermatogenesis. Okay, so these two muscles you have to remember, diatos muscles and cremaster muscle. Okay, okay, so all the things, these are related to the scrotal sac. Okay, once we will revise, and next we will see the structure of testes. Fine. Now scrotal or scrotal sac, it is a highly pigmented pouch which is located extra abdominal, but it is in contact with the abdominal cavity by means of a short canal or the narrow canal, that is known as inguinal canal. This inguinal canal is lined by cremaster muscle. Okay, these cremaster muscles are also present in the wall of scrotal sac. Every scrotal sac or each segment, each lobe, okay, it has one testis and epididymis. From epididymis starts the vas deferentia. Vas deferentia, along with blood vessel, nerves, it form a cord that is known as spermatic cord. Okay, this spermatic cord help the testing aid to maintain its position in the scrotal sac. The wall of scrotum, okay, is made up of special type of muscles. These are known as cremaster muscle and diatos muscle. They help in the elevation of testes and they maintain the internal temperature of scrotal sac. Each testis is attached to the dorsal wall of scrotal sac by means of a tract of elastic fibers that is known as gubernaculum or mesorchia. Fine. So these are the points related to the structure, position, of scrotal sac and testes. Okay. Now in the next class we will see the longitudinal section of testes. First we will see the longitudinal section of testes, what is the internal structure of testes, and after that we will see the structure of seminiferous tubule. Seminiferous tubule, it is the actual part where process of spermatogenesis takes place. Fine. So today which points we discussed? We discussed the overall reproductive system in humans, okay, which are primary sex organs, which are secondary sex organs. Then we studied different parts of male reproductive system. In that we studied external aspects of testes. We have not yet completed the internal structure. Histological aspects we will study in next lecture. Okay, so I hope you have understood this part. Just revise this part properly. If you have any doubt, you are free to ask. Okay, so now we will meet in next lecture. In next lecture we will try to complete the internal structure of testes, internal structure of seminiferous tubule and accessory glands. Okay, fine. So this is for the day. Okay, take care and be in contact. Thank you so much.